Hey everyone, in this video, we're going to be walking through a natural cubic spline interpolation example. If you missed our previous video on the theory of cubic spline interpolation, I will leave a link to that in the description down below for you. Before we jump into this example, let's quickly recap what cubic spline interpolation is. Cubic spline interpolation is a mathematical technique used to approximate a smooth curve passing through a given set of points. It's especially useful in situations where we have scattered data points and we want to create a continuous curve that captures a general trend. We can then use that curve to find valuable information about our data. All right, let's take a look at our example. Here we have a set of data points representing the growth of a plant over time. Our goal is to interpolate a smooth curve that accurately represents the growth pattern between these supplied discrete data points. As you can see, we have four data points, and our task is to find the natural cubic spline that passes through these points. As we learned in our cubic spline interpolation theory video, we know that we were always going to have one less spline than our number of supplied data points. Therefore, with four data points, we will have three splines to fit cubic functions to. We also learned that for each spline we need to find, denoted by n, we will need four n equations, such that we can solve for our 4n missing coefficients. Therefore, we have 12 missing coefficients, as you can see here. So, let's quickly make a plan of attack on how we want to go about solving this problem. First, we need to find 12 equations such that we can solve for our 12 missing coefficients. Once we have the 12 equations, we will plug them into a linear system of equations solver and then be complete with this problem. But stay with me and we'll walk through this problem fully together. So, let's begin working out how to find our 12 equations. As we learned in the previous theory video, we can get 2n equations through evaluating each of the three polynomial functions at our known data points. So, let's just go ahead and do that. All we're doing here is plugging in our x values at our known points and simplifying. But to elaborate a bit more, we're going to evaluate our first polynomial with its two data points, so x1 and x2. p2 will be evaluated at x2 and x3, and lastly, p3 will be evaluated at x3 and x4. As you can see, when we are done here, this results in 6 of our 12 equations. Secondly, as we learned in the cubic spline interpolation video, we can find n-1 equations through the property of smoothness at our first derivatives of our interior data points, which in this example will give us 2 more equations as we have 2 interior data points, and you can see that here. Again, like we just previously did, we can do the same thing with second derivatives as we know we have continuity there as well. And this will also give us n-1 equations. To get the first equation here, we are going to take the derivative of our previously calculated first derivative of p1 and p2. Then we are going to equate them and plug in our x value where the continuity is occurring, which is x equals 3. This works out to the following equation, and I'm just going to rearrange it, such that all variables are on one side and the constant on the other side. Secondly, we can repeat this process with our second interior data point, between p2 and p3. Therefore, we will again take the derivative of our first derivative p2 and p3 functions we found earlier, and evaluate them at x equals x3, which is 5. And again, we will rearrange this equation to put all variables on one side, and just leave our constant, which is 0, on the other side of the equation. Now, as you can see, we have 10 equations and we are only missing 2. We were told to assume a natural cubic spline, so let's do that. In a natural cubic spline, we assume that the second derivative of our endpoints are both equal to zero, meaning at that point it is simply a straight line. So let's just go ahead and calculate the second derivative of P1 and P3 at points x1 and x4 respectively to get our remaining two equations. And again, just ensure that we are always rearranging our equations to put all our variables on one side, and we'll leave our constant, which is a zero in this case, on the other side of the equation. Now that we have all of our 12 equations, we can solve for our 12 unknowns. To do this, we could try doing it manually. However, this would not be fun and take a while. Through using simple polynomials, we will always have linear equations, and therefore we have a system of linear equations. And from our previous lessons in this course, we actually know how to solve these. So I'm just going to write out our matrix so that we know what we are trying to solve. You can think of all these columns here as our coefficient values for each of our equations. And I will write this out here so that it's easier to visualize. Now, I'm going to use our Gauss elimination solver with partial pivoting that we developed in a previous numerical methods video. I will leave a link to that video also in the description down below if you missed it. However, there are systems of linear equation solvers online that you can find by Googling them. Now that we are inside Python, I have opened the Gauss elimination system of equations solver with partial pivoting. I took a minute already and entered our square matrix we just wrote down and entered in our variables and constant matrices here. We just need to call our function and insert our variable matrix and then our constant matrix and run the program. And as you can see, we have now solved for our 12 unknowns. Each of these x values represents a coefficient of our three interpolating polynomials. x0 is a1, x1 is b1, x2 is c1, x3 is d1, and so on. To visualize these polynomials, I'm just going to plot them rather crudely inside of Microsoft Excel, keeping in mind our domains that we have talked about previously. As you can see, this results in the following very nice smooth function. Now, back to our blackboard, we can now solve the second question we are being asked. We were asked to evaluate the interpolating polynomials at inputs of 1.5, 4, and 7. Quickly, I'm just going to write out our polynomials and their respective domains. For an input of 1.5, we are going to be using our first interpolating polynomial based on our domains. This results in an output of 1.876. Secondly, for an input of 4, it falls on our second interpolating polynomial, which has an output of 5.9. Lastly, for our input of 7, we will use our third and final interpolating polynomial. This results in an output of 10.58, and we have now answered all the questions that we are being asked. I hope that this video helped your understanding of how we go about solving a natural cubic spline interpolation problem. If you enjoyed, please like, subscribe, and consider checking out our YouTube memberships by clicking that join button down below. However, if you have any comments, questions, or concerns about the information I provided in this video, please leave a comment down below and I will do my best to address your concerns.